Philippine Army Chief Romeo Bronner tapped to replace General Andres Centino as the country's Armed Forces Chief of Staff. Lieutenant General Bronner has been in the military for 34 years, holding key posts. He was inducted in March into the International Fellows Hall of Fame of the U.S. Army War College. He was also recognized for his service as Philippine Army Commander. As for Centino, he will now serve as presidential advisor on the West Philippine Sea. On Twitter, President Marcos said he believes Bronner and Centino can help in boosting the defense capabilities of the Philippines amid ongoing geopolitical tensions. The Philippine Supreme Court affirms the dismissal of an ill-gotten wealth case against the parents of President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. and their alleged cronies. The case was dismissed in September 2019 by the Sandigan Bayan Anti-Graft Court. It said the claims by the Presidential Commission on Good Government lacked merit and violated the best evidence rule. The High Court agreed the Commission failed to present sufficient evidence against the accused. Now, the forfeiture case was filed in 1987 against Marcos Sr., his wife Imelda, retail tycoon Bienvenido Tantoco Sr., and a number of Tantoco's relatives. Marcos Sr. was accused of unlawfully withdrawing 1.52 billion pesos from the National Treasury, the Central Bank, and other financial institutions, and then transferring the funds to his associates. A 2.15 million, peso civil suit filed against Lorraine Badoy, the former spokesperson of the Philippine government's anti-communist task force. The suit was filed by Carol Pagaduan Araulo, the chairperson emeritus of the progressive group, Bayan. Araulo claims Badoy and co-accused Jeffrey Celis damaged her name and that of her organization with their red-tagging allegations. Araulo cites remarks with Badoy and Celis made through their social media accounts and on their program aired by SMNI. Badoy dubbed the civil suit a useless crybaby case. She urged Araulo to sue them for libel and to wait for their counter lawsuit. The Philippine Supreme Court bars the Marcos administration's former press secretary, Trixie Cruz Angeles, from practicing law for 6 months. The court penalized Cruz Angeles for being abusive and using language in a pleading filed for her client. This is the second time Cruz Angeles was suspended from practicing law. She resigned as press secretary last year, citing health concerns. The Philippine Justice Secretary is slamming the International Criminal Court's decision to push ahead with its probe into the Duterte administration's drug war. Secretary Jesus Crispin Remulla says the ICC should not interfere in affairs of the country. He adds he was not surprised by the ICC's decision, but he points out the ruling was not unanimous, as two of the five judges voted in favor of Manila's appeal.
Tamang landas tayo na pag-iisip tungkol sa sovereignty ng Pilipinas na hindi tayo pwedeng magpasakop sa mga taong nais pakialaman ang sistema ng justisya na gumagana naman sa ating bansa. Kaya ang pakikialam sa ating bansa ng mga banyagang ito ay para bang senyalis din na gusto nilang bumalik sa panahon ng colonialism, no? Nagawin tayong kolonya na hindi tayo papayag.
Manila's top economist gives his assurance the country's new sovereign wealth fund will not plunge the Philippines into further debt. Socioeconomic Planning Secretary Arsenio Balisacan spoke a day after President Marcos signed the bill creating the Maharlika Investment Fund. Balisacan says the fund will enable the Philippines to establish more revenue streams and reduce debt reliance. He says this is crucial to elevating the country to upper middle income status in the next few years.
If the officers and the board will do their work properly, then there's no reason why they can't do their work properly. If, you know, if the governance structure of the fund is put in place, a good governance structure. Then, you know, it should be able to earn much more than what you are paying, for example, for death.
Philippine National Economic and Development Authority approves the 170.6 billion pesos solicited bid to privatize operations of Manila's main gateway. The project, which has a 15-year term, is set to be undertaken by the Transportation Department and Manila International Airport Authority. Now, this would mean that the 267 billion peso unsolicited proposal of a mega consortium will not push through.
The unsolicited track is already closed, at least for this project. Ensure that those that unsolicited contracts that are still live would have to be returned. Open and competitive bidding, usually for the benefit of the public and the government, because we don't know what's best until we get the various offers.
The consortium meanwhile says it understands NEDA's decision. It adds it is aligned with the government's commitment to revitalize NAIA, but it did not say if it will join the bidding. The privatization aims to address issues hounding the airport and increase its capacity. This is among the nearly 200 priority infrastructure projects of the Philippine government. Trade Secretary Alfredo Pascual bullish the Philippines will climb in the top three nations in Asia with the highest foreign direct investments by the end of President Marcos's term. Speaking to ANC's Business Outlook, Pascual said the country has already logged 290 investment projects in the first year of the Marcos administration. This, he said, is due to policy reforms made by the government.
We've already touched on one important accomplishment, which is to build up our pipeline of foreign direct investment potential. That's happening in the approvals that are being made by the Board of Investment, BOI, of which I'm the chair, and it operates under DTI, and also PESA. And the presidential visits, we have more than a dozen, and DTI has always taken the lead in organizing the business activities, including the one-on-one meetings with prospective investors, the roundtable discussions with other investors, and a general investment and business forum, you know, that will include many more participants. We've done that in a number of countries. These are all the sources of investment. We could feel, you know, the growing interest in the Philippines. Some say that we're becoming the favorite in the region.
Pascual also underscoring government's plans to increase renewable energy projects in the country. He said this will help avert a power crisis and mitigate the effects of climate change.
The first quarter, we had requests for or applications for approval coming from renewable energy companies, particularly offshore wind, which are which will amount to hundreds of millions of euros from Germany. There are other projects that will follow in the wake of this initial entry. Very aggressive plans for increasing the share of renewables in our power generation mix. Right now, we're 25%. But mostly geothermal and hydro. And we want the renewable component of our energy mix to get to 35% by 2030 and by 50% by 2050.
The Philippines' top court orders the Makati City government to pay the Bureau of Internal Revenue a total of 1.26 billion in deficiency taxes. Of that sum, 1.5 billion pesos in deficiency taxes covers the years 1999 to 2001. 217.81 million pesos in deficiency taxes, meanwhile, were from 2002 to 2004. The Supreme Court also junked both Makati City government's petition and its motion to dismiss the case.